For those of you who maybe are not sure about what Creation Ministries is all about, if I could just take a few minutes explaining, because we're a group of six ministries in six different countries that cooperate together. It sort of makes us look a lot bigger than we are. We share the same website, the same magazine, the Creation magazine, the same Journal of Creation, which is a peer-reviewed science journal. And between us, we probably hire more PhD scientists than any Christian ministry in the world. And we do that because we see ourselves as an information ministry called to arm and equip and encourage God's people in the face of all of the evolutionary challenges to the faith, you know, the latest ape man, the latest missing link claim and so on, and also to help Christians to answer those questions. You know, if you share your faith, you get them all the time. If there's a God of love, how come there's all this death, pain and suffering in the world? What about dinosaurs? How do they fit the Bible? How could Cain get a wife if he wasn't able? Maybe not put like that. But those sorts of things that many non-Christians think there are no answers to. And so often they've given up asking those questions, and we'll try and cover a lot of them if we can. And one of the most important tools we use to see that information spread is the Creation magazine. I'll mention more about that later. 56 pages of full colour. And of course, we have volunteers like the Adelaide Friends of CMI group who give up their weekends lugging around books and setting them up at churches like this because they understand how important it is to get that information out there. For example, there's the Creation Answers book, which answers 60 of those questions in 20 categories, like dinosaurs and Cain's wife and so on, but also things like the origin of the races, what about radiocarbon dating, ice age, continental drift, those sorts of things. And what excites me is that that book's also available free. You can download it chapter by chapter from the internet. And so people in countries like India and Philippines and so on that often can't afford books like this and magazines like we can actually access that information for free. And that brings me to our website, and that has over 9,000 articles on it and powerful search engine, and there's a new article being added every day. We've tried to make the name easy to remember. It's a little bit tough, just wait for it. It's creation.com. Do you think you can remember that? I know it's tough, but everything you need to know about creation, creation.com. Because, you know, people can also look at the Q&A section, and if you don't get an answer to your question tonight or you missed asking me, then you can find the answer there. And we'll also tell people about exciting things happening in the Christian world, like, for example, when the world's leading atheist philosopher, Sir Anthony Flew, changed his mind and said there must be a God, based upon the sort of evidence from molecular biology. And of course, how do we let you know when there's an exciting new article on the website, or how do we tell you when there's something special happening in your region? We do so through a free email newsletter. And this is an unashamed plug for you to sign on if you don't already, because why wouldn't you? There's no obligation, no cost, and you can unsubscribe at the click of a mouse. And this is what the sign-up sheets will look like in just a few moments, and they have your name, email, and also your postcode, so you don't get things meant for Singapore or South Africa cluttering up your inbox. That's why we ask for your postcode. And while I'm talking, if I can ask our volunteers from the Adelaide Friends of CMI to get those boards moving. And friends, one of the issues that we've got in this ministry is that often you go into a church and you know there's a lot of Christians that are sitting there thinking, well, I know God is creator and I know that Jesus loves me, and what does it matter how or when God created? You know, friends, the atheists, they know that this is a huge issue. For instance, here's one of them, Dr. William Provine from the world-famous Cornell University, and he said, belief in modern evolution makes atheists of people. One can have a religious view that is compatible with evolution only if the religious view is indistinguishable from atheism. Now, you might think that's a little bit over the top, but I actually think he's quite logical, and that's the reason why I was an atheist all through university, even though I'd read the Bible, read lots of religious books, and lots of people would come up to witness to me from time to time. And you know, when you boil down what is taught as fact in schools, colleges, and universities, it's essentially this. Now, students, hydrogen is a gas which, if left long enough, turns into people. That's it. That's really the crux of it. And you know, friends, prominent atheists were often brought up as Christians, like the famous Richard Dawkins, a professor of biology and so on. And he's very conscious of the fact that efforts to mix and match Christianity and evolution are frankly hopeless. You know, once he was interviewed on a Christian TV station in the United Kingdom, and the interviewer said to him, "And was there a particular point or something that you read or an experience that you had that sort of said, yep, this is it, God doesn't exist?" And Dawkins said, "Oh, well, by far the most important, I suppose, was understanding evolution. I think the evangelical Christians have really sort of got it right in a way in seeing evolution as the enemy. Whereas the more, what shall we say, sophisticated theologians who are quite happy to live with evolution, I think they're deluded," said Dawkins. "I think the evangelicals have got it right, and that there really is a deep incompatibility between evolution and Christianity. And I think I realized that at the age of about 16. And you know, let's explore that incompatibility a bit, and let's do that by hearing what another prominent atheist, Frank Zindler, had to say as part of a debate against a Christian philosopher. He said, "If there never was an Adam and Eve, and that's what evolution implies, because populations evolve, individuals don't, then there never was an original sin." You see, that's the whole point of the gospel, isn't it? That our first ancestor, Adam, rebelled against his maker, and as a consequence, we've inherited that propensity to sin, to turn away from God individually, collectively, and so on. And there's this huge chasm between us and God. And the whole reason Jesus Christ came to earth to take our penalty for the forgiveness of our sin has to do with the fact that he came to earth to be our relative into Adam's line, to overcome what the Bible calls this curse of death and bloodshed and so on that's affected the whole world. You see, the whole big picture of the gospel is a good world ruined by sin to be restored in the future. Can you see how it makes a huge difference to that issue of, if there's a God of love, how come there's all that death, pain, and suffering in the world? But you see, you know, just these last few days, I've been visiting my sister in hospital, and she's just discovered that she has terminal cancer, and she knows where she's going, because she knows why all of this is here, that there's been that curse, and that the world and individual people who believe will be redeemed through Jesus Christ, the last Adam. So here's this atheist who understands that, and he says, if there never was an original sin, there is no need of salvation. If there's no need of salvation, there's no need of a savior. And I submit that puts Jesus, historical or otherwise, into the ranks of the unemployed. You know, friends, if the Bible's right, there's also an adversary to God. And that means, and the Bible actually calls him Satan, the devil, father of lies, the one who deceives the whole world. And that means one of the ways in which he's going to do it is to try to get away from people believing that God made all things, and that Genesis, which tells us how sin and death entered the world, which is the whole reason why Christ came to die, that can't be right, and so on. And this whole evolutionary big picture undermines all of that. Now think about it, even the millions of years on its own is enough to destroy the logic of the gospel. What do I mean? You see, consider where the idea of millions of years came from. It didn't come from radiometric dating. Friends, all of those millions of years, that whole belief system was there well before Darwin and well before radioactivity was even discovered. It comes from the belief that the fossils, those real billions of dead things that you see buried in rock layers all over the world, were not formed by a massive watery catastrophe that the Bible describes, which is what the father of modern geology believed and what most of the great scientists of the past believed, but instead were formed slowly and gradually by the sorts of processes that you see today. Now, if the fossils were formed millions of years ago, that means they must have formed before there were people. So let's see where that belief leaves us as Christians. It has Adam and Eve standing on a record of this death, and there's also struggle and violence shown in the fossils, animals eating each other and so on, and lots of cancer, like the sort of thing that still afflicts people and animals today in the fossil record. And according to Genesis, after God had made everything, he saw everything that he had made, which included Adam and Eve, and he said, and behold, it was all very good. Can you see how that totally undermines the idea that there once was a good world, ruined by sin, to be restored in the future? You see, the New Testament doesn't talk about death as something that God loves and that he was happy about for billions of years and so on before there were people. Rather, talks about death as an enemy. In fact, Paul says, when he talks about death, he says, the last enemy to be destroyed is death. You know, the whole of the New Testament talks about that Genesis curse, but it does so in ways that sort of, I don't mean the whole thing, but it refers to the whole big picture of Genesis history. And it does so in a way that assumes that you've read the first bit and that you know what Paul is talking about. For example, in Romans 8, Paul says in verse 22, for we know that the whole creation has been groaning together like in the pains of childbirth until now. He assumes that you know that it's groaning because of the fact that God cursed his once good creation as a consequence of this incredible thing. Now, you might think it's not a big deal, man rebelling against God, but God is utterly holy. He cannot tolerate evil of any description. In fact, he defines what's good and what's bad. You know, if someone says to you, oh, it's bad when it says this in the Bible or something, ask them, how do you even know what good and bad is without God? You know, you go back a couple of verses and Paul makes it even more clear. He says, for the creation was subjected to futility, not willingly, but because of him who subjected it. God subjected this creation to show us the seriousness of sin, if you like, in hope that the creation itself will be set free from its bondage to decay and obtain the freedom of the glory of the children of God. In other words, not only individual believers will live forever to be with Christ, but will do that in a new heavens and a new earth, a restored creation in which there'll be no violence and death and suffering and those sorts of things. Even the animals will revert to a state of original harmony. That's where you've probably heard about, you know, wolves and lambs lying down together. Even if you aren't a Christian, that comes from the Bible, the prophet Isaiah, looking forward to a time when that will come. You know, in the book of Revelation, we read about the fact that there's a time coming when there'll be no more death, no more pain, no more suffering. We go to a lot of different churches in Creation Ministries, and I know there's all sorts of different opinions about the fine details of the future, but praise God, pretty well everyone agrees that there's a time coming when there'll be no more death. And the Bible tells us, word for word, why that will be. Because there shall be no more curse. What's that talking about? The Genesis curse. Can you see how important this whole Genesis big picture is to the gospel big picture? There's not just some little side issue. And can you see how clever it is for Satan to try and sort of undermine the credibility of the gospel by making it look as if somehow it's unscientific to believe in that history in the Bible. You know, Jesus built his whole doctrine of marriage on those literal historical events in Genesis. He said, haven't you read? He that made them male and female from the beginning of the creation, he believed in a literal Adam, believed in a literal Eve. And the Bible tells us he's the creator. He was there. He is the truth. He knows all things. He doesn't lie. And he says, and for this cause, a man shall leave his father and mother, and the two shall be one flesh. What's he talking about? What's the one flesh all about? Well, Genesis also tells us that woman was made from man's rib originally. Adam said, bone of my bone, flesh of my flesh. In marriage, we are supposed to be so close to one another, ideally, emotionally and metaphorically as if we really were one flesh, literally and historically, because Adam and Eve really were one flesh. And I can't resist a little aside here. I might have mentioned that I trained as a medical practitioner. I'm not practicing anymore. I've sort of got the hang of it now. But some time ago, when I actually left my practice here and moved to Cairns, in the process of moving, I had a very serious car accident. Fell asleep at the wheel in the outback of Australia and at highway speeds went headlong into an oncoming fully laden fuel tanker. Not recommended. And spent 5.5 months back in the Royal Adelaide, and they did lots of operations, 56 altogether. So if you're facing surgery, be encouraged. I can vouch for the fact that it gets a lot easier after the first 30 or so. And most of these were taking bits of bone from my side and hip and other places and mostly rebuilding my face. So what you see is not what you get. And anyway, one day I'd had several of these ops and I was in hospital still. And the plastic surgeon came to my bedside and he said, "Dr. Whelan, tomorrow we're going to do another op. And this time we'll go into the same scar, same place, take some more bone and put it in your nose this time." And I said, "You know, you guys, you keep going back to the same side. Why don't you go around the other side? I mean, aren't you going to run out of bone there one day?" And he looked at me a bit strangely, as if, "Didn't they teach you anything in medical school?" And he said, "Didn't you know we take the whole rib out every time?" And I said, "Huh?" And he said, "Didn't you know the rib's the only bone in the body that if you leave the periosteum behind, which is like a membrane-like clad wrap that covers every bone, and with the rib, when you take out the rib, you can easily leave that membrane behind and peel out the rib." He said, "Most of the time, it'll just grow straight back again." And I thought, wow, that's really neat. God knew what he was doing. Adam didn't have to walk around with a defect the rest of his life, you know. It just grew back again. And if you don't believe me, I say, come up afterwards and I'll let you see the scar and you can tap on it where the same rib came back for me 5 or 6 times. The reason why marriage is a man for a woman and not a man for a man or a woman for a woman or whatever's popular these days, you know, is because God literally made a man and a woman, not any of these other combinations. You know, I don't think it's a surprise that we see this push now to redefine marriage, which is really defined in the book of Genesis, because unfortunately, the majority of the church gave up defending Genesis a long time ago, thinking, oh, we don't want to be embarrassed. You know, it must be unscientific simply because the fashionable patterns in science and philosophy and so on were going that way. I think the surprise is that it's taken that long. But one thing is for sure, that our culture is a lot less influenced by the good things in Christianity than it used to be. My parents were not Christians. I did not grow up in a Christian home. But my parents, like most people in those days in our society, lived by the Christian ethic. You know, there were so many things were different. You know, for example, it was just obvious that it was wrong to steal, that marriage was a man for a woman and all sorts of things. You know, many young people are surprised to hear that when I was a lad, the first Holden cars were made without needing an ignition key to start them. Many people would go shopping and leave their keys in the ignition of a car. Anybody here remember that? Yeah, there's a few, but put up your hand if you'd still do that today. Not many, not a smart idea. And of course, it's harder and harder to reach people with the gospel. And you know, lots of young people in America, for example, are dropping out from churches in a massive epidemic. And of course, that makes sense because Jesus, in another context in John 3:12, said, "I've spoken to you of earthly things and you do not believe. How then will you believe if I speak of heavenly things?" What sense does it make to tell people there to believe in some airy-fairy thing that they can't really feel and touch? If you tell them, well, you can't trust the history, the geology, the biology and so on that the Bible's all about. What do you mean the Bible's? The Bible's not about science. Friends, the Bible talks about the origin and the history of man. What's that? Anthropology. But you know what? this is not all bad news for Christians. It also means that it's a fantastic tool for reaching out to people when you can show them that the facts of the real world really do make sense within that biblical big picture. You know, people say, well, science, you know, church isn't about that, and Christianity's, you know, we're not supposed to be argumentative, but we're not supposed to duck the arguments either. Do you think it really gives us any respect if we say, oh, well, when someone challenges on something to do with the history and the Bible, we say, oh, we don't want to talk about that, we want to change the subject? It's not really going to answer those sincere questions that people have. You know, sometimes the questions are an excuse, though, aren't they? Sometimes the real issue is our moral standing before God. But we put up this evolutionary smokescreen and we say, you know, science has disproved the Bible and so on. You know, the apostles, they were engaging in the arguments in the marketplace. They said, Paul in 2 Corinthians 10:5, he said, we demolish arguments. That's not the same as being argumentative, and every pretension that sets itself up against the knowledge of God. Now, you know as well as I do that in a brief presentation like this, I can't do more than give you a big picture understanding. And each of you has different needs. Some of you have got degrees, maybe PhDs. Some of you just want a basic understanding and so on. So if you want to go further, if even the question time doesn't help, there's our website, there's resources and so on. But let me just talk about a few big picture things. The first thing I want to talk about is the fact that this idea that it's science versus religion is simply nonsense. Because you see, science is a wonderful thing. I love science. We love science. We love especially the sort of science that's given us rockets to the moon and things that are real and things that work, because that's all about experiment, observation in the present. You know, the law of gravity, the laws by which the world works and so on. That's got nothing to do with ideas about one-off past events, like whether reptiles turned into birds 150 million years ago, or whether they were created 6,000 years ago in separate groups with the capacity to vary. Like the Bible says, you can't run experiments to observe or repeat the past. It's a different sort of science that's involved. You could call it historical or forensic science, if you like paleontology, archaeology, crime scene investigation and so on, where you start with observations, but then you make up a story to explain the observations, and there's usually more than one story that fits the same observation. And the problem is, in our culture, most of us have been brought up with only one story. And so I'm saying to you that if you're not a Christian this evening, just do it for the sake of the argument. Just say, okay, let's assume the Bible's history is right. What would you expect the world to look like, and how does it match with what you actually see? So this really important point is that we're dealing on the one hand with operational science, how the world operates, how it works, experimental science, it's all about observing things in the present, repeating them and so on, and historical science, which is about the unobservable, unrepeatable past. In fact, some philosophers of science, even an Australian evolutionist educator, admitted this. He said, the Genesis account of creation may even be the correct one, but there is no way science can prove or disprove that, and the creationists know it. That's important, isn't it? In other words, we're talking about belief systems, we're talking about interpretation. You see, philosophers of science have long known that facts do not speak for themselves. I know people who will look at deep canyons and layers and they'll say, oh, look, it's obvious. The millions of years, they just hit you in the face, you know? So if they're a Christian, they say, well, I'd better reinterpret the Bible. Or if they think really carefully about the gospel, they say, well, I can't believe the gospel because of that. That's where I was at. And, you know, the thing is this, that even if it took millions of years to form those things, you couldn't possibly say that the facts tell you that. How can I show you that easily? Because the great fathers of modern science, brilliant minds like Sir Isaac Newton, they saw layers, they saw canyons, not one of them ever saw the millions of years. So why do we see it today? Because we're digesting, interpreting the facts through a machinery, if you like, which a belief system which said that these things happened slowly and gradually and that there was no such thing as a worldwide flood. Because you see, what would you expect to be true if Genesis is history, because there's a very sober account in the Bible that takes three whole chapters about a worldwide flood, and incredibly, there's going to be a movie soon, a bit fictionalized, but still getting the point across, a global catastrophe. The one with Russell Crowe in it is the film on Noah I'm talking about. And that is not talking about a few days and nights of drizzle. That's talking about something in which the fountains of the great deep broke up before it began to rain. Can you imagine the crust of the earth tearing open all over the earth and water pouring out? You know, you can't have that happening without having an awful lot of earthquake and tectonic and volcanic activity. And the Bible says those fountains kept pouring for weeks and weeks and weeks before they were shut. And the waters kept prevailing and prevailing, and it was over a year before Noah and his family could set foot on dry ground. And at the end of that catastrophe in Psalm 104, which is referring to God's rainbow promise never to send such a flood again, we read the mountains rose up, the valleys sank down, and the waters hastened away at the sound of your thunder to where you've set a boundary where they may no longer turn to cover the earth. Friends, what would you expect to find if there was such a catastrophe? Billions of dead things buried in rock layers, laid down by moving water all over the world. You know, for those of you who don't come to this church, I won't tell you who it is, but there was a guy on the stage here this evening who's doing his PhD in a geological subject. He has no problem understanding that the facts of geology line up with the Genesis flood. You know, one of the reasons I think why we tend to see this as a bit of a fairy tale thing is because of these sorts of images for little kids, you know. If you've got that in your mind, well, no wonder you're thinking maybe this is just like Aesop's fables and, you know, a dinky little toy tub like that with a couple of giraffes poking out. Let's ignore these man-made caricatures. The Bible actually gives you the dimensions of the ark, and it's an awesome vessel. And there it is compared to those, you know, big Australian semi-trailers and to people, and it's got a carrying capacity of 15,000 tons. And if you do the mathematics, there is ample room for all the animals that needed to be on board. They didn't need to be the millions of species that live in the sea, for example, and so on. And, you know, people say, well, I can see now where the water could have come from, and yeah, I can see how the animals fitted in, because, by the way, Noah didn't have to take two pairs, or you know, a pair each of wolves, dingoes, coyotes, Great Danes, and so on. So all of those can still hybridize. They're all part of the same created kind. He only had to take two of the canine kind and so on. And they say, well, yeah, I can see that, but if there was such a flood, well, where's the water now, you know, covering all the world and so on? And you say, can you guess? I mean, we live on an incredibly soggy planet. I mean, there is so much water there. Did you know that if you reverse that process in your mind in Psalm 104, push down those uplifted mountains, push up those ocean valleys, the deep ocean trenches and so on, so that the whole thing is smooth like a ping pong ball, you would have enough water to cover the globe to an average depth all the way around of 2.7 kilometres. Plenty of water. You know, and if you've been thinking, well, but, how come you've got all the different layers? I mean, doesn't sort of one layer equal one time period? Well, that's maybe what they used to teach, but they can't teach it anymore, because the facts show otherwise. You see, here is a cliff face in northwestern United States. There's a person there for scale, and there's about 8 meters of thousands of individual sedimentary layers. This is not lava. Sedimentary means laid down by moving fluids. Now, those thousands of layers, some of them are only 1 millimeter apart, and traditional teaching is there had to be at least a year between each one of those layers. But we know that's not true, because we know that whole 8 meters was laid down in one afternoon, June the 12th, 1980. It was one of the eruptions of Mount St. Helens. There was lots of molten snow, and there were ash flows, and there were mud flows, and all sorts of sedimentary activity, and even large canyons carved out, some of them through solid crystalline rock. What am I getting at? But you don't need millions of years if your forces are big enough. And compared to the fountains of the great deep breaking up all over the world for five whole months, Mount St. Helens would have been like a damp firecracker. Even the very existence of fossils speaks of rapid processes, not the sort of slow and gradual picture that most of us have in our minds. You know, here's an example of that picture when it comes to well-preserved fish fossils. There are billions of well-preserved fish fossils in rocks around the globe. You can buy them at every rock shop, you know, showing you fins and scales preserved and so on. And here's an old South Australian textbook from high school and showing you how fossils are supposed to form. And see the three panels from left to right, how the mountains are going down, down, down. That's supposed to show you millions of years of erosion. And so the belief is that millions of years ago the fish died and it sank to the bottom, and then these bits of mud and sand eroded from the mountains. They sort of settled gradually on that fish, and then it gradually hardened and turned into rock, and then we have a fossil. Isn't that sort of the general idea that people have? Friends, your common sense will tell you you cannot possibly get a well-preserved fish fossil like that. First of all, what happens to most fish when they die? Do they sink to the bottom like the textbook shows, or do they float? If you don't believe me, use the experimental method. Teaspoon of cyanide, go home to your goldfish bowl, see what happens. And if you've done that, and you've got your poor little goldfish floating on top, you know, what will you do to turn it into a fossil? Will you throw it in at Outer Harbour or into the Torrens, you know, if it's ever running, or something like that, and wait for thousands of years? Of course not. In the real world, what happens? You know, the seagulls rip into it, the scraps quickly sink to the bottom, and then everything else comes in for a feed. You know, crabs, sea lice, everything, within 24 hours. You're very lucky if you've got more than a backbone and maybe a couple of ribs poking out. You know, you don't go out snorkeling on the sea and see all the dead fish lying there waiting to be fossilized, do you? You know, one half covered up, one 3/4 covered up because he's been there for 500 years and so on. It's not the real world, you know? So what would you need to do to have a chance of forming some sort of fossil showing you the fins and the scales? Well, for a start, you'd need to bury your fish quickly so it couldn't get ripped apart and eaten. So we know today of things called turbidity currents. These happen in our day when there's a little bit of an earthquake off the continental shelf. The mud and the ooze that's lying there, it slumps towards the deeper ocean basins, and as it does so, it picks up more and more speed and substance like a snowball. And these have been known to carry millions of tons of sediment at measured speeds underwater, of express train speeds, and obviously burying everything in their path. And if a little earthquake can do that, there would have been heaps of that during the time of the flood for 5 whole months. And so that way you stop your fish being ripped apart and eaten. But even that's not enough, because you see, unless that stuff has the right cementing ingredients to go hard within a few weeks at the most, then you're still going to have moisture, bacteria and oxygen accessing that dead fish. And so you will never get the fins and the scales preserved, at best a few bones. And so what does it mean when you see billions of well-preserved fish fossils? They had to be buried rapidly. They had to fossilize, harden rapidly. The right cementing ingredients. What's cement? Ground up rock and water. What would there have been lots of at the time of the flood? Ground up rock and water. By the way, remember I said we can't prove or disprove the past. I'm not trying to prove Noah's flood to you. All I'm saying is it's consistent with it. In other words, if you start with faith in God's word, it's not a blind faith or a dumb faith, but the big picture fits. You know, sometimes the evidence for rapid burial is even more spectacular. Here's a fish buried so quickly it never had time to finish its lunch. See that? You know, by the way, we don't have time to go into all of the, what I think are exciting things about biology. This is how the sorts of changes that we see in real things like natural selection and mutation are actually sorting things out to go downhill, to lose more and more information to drive them closer to extinction. But don't take my word for it. Here's one of the leading scientists in the whole field of genes and DNA, former Cornell professor John Sanford, and he's a pioneer of gene engineering. He invented the gene gun for transgenic crops and things like to take the genes from one type of crop and put them in another and so on. World famous guy, and he became a Christian and a creationist and a recent creationist, in other words, a Genesis Bible believing Christian on the basis of the sorts of evidence that's coming up today in this field of DNA. And he says, for example, even with intense selection, evolution is going the wrong way toward extinction. The bottom line is that Darwinian theory fails on every level. You know, friends, just as a bit of an aside, you know, the Bible tells us, be ready to have answers. Always be prepared to give an answer to everyone who asks you, to give the reason for the hope that you have, but do this with gentleness and respect. But what happens if people have given up asking questions because they assume there are no answers, because they've heard the questions ducked too many times? Well, you know what? There's a way in which you, as a Christian, and if you're non-Christian, listen to this too, it'll be interesting, because you can actually be in a position of getting someone to hopefully explain to you what their objection is to Christianity. I mean, why wouldn't you accept this amazing gift of eternal life? Why not? You know, here's an article by a Melbourne IT program as part of our Melbourne Friends of CMI. I'll give you that as a search term so you can look this article up. It's her first name, spelt like the yoke of an ox and so on. We're called Why Not and Why, The Power of Asking the Right Questions. She was in a bookshop looking for antique Bibles. And the man, that's her hobby, and the man who was serving her seemed to know a lot about Bibles. And so she said quite innocently, oh, are you a Christian? And he said, no. It was obviously a very threatening question. And she said immediately, with a very charming smile, she said, why not? And when I heard that, I thought, that's it, you know. Why not ask someone in a very friendly way? Oh, why aren't you a Christian? And, you know, he thought about it. By the way, you try it, and you'll find that often the objection has to do with this science issue. They might not come at you with some sophisticated scientific theory, because even a lot of scientists don't know that much about evolution, but unless they're specialists in that field. But this guy said, dinosaurs, I guess. Yeah, dinosaurs. So what was he getting at? Why should dinosaurs have anything to do with not being a Christian? Well, you know, the idea of dinosaurs comes packaged with an idea about a mysterious world before time in which things are fighting and killing each other long before there's any Adam and Eve in a Garden of Eden. So it's sort of like contrasts with this is the real world and this is a fairy tale type of thing. And she knew that, and she was pressured for time, so she only had time to give him a brief outline, and I'll give you that brief outline here. But she referred him to creation.com, and he left saying thank you, warmly shaking her hand after being sort of quite threatened, to saying, I promise I will type in dinosaurs and look for that on creation.com. Because many of you, if you're non-Christians, you will understand that you might feel a bit awkward about Christianity, but at the same time, you've got some real questions and you want to be taken seriously. And one of those questions might be about dinosaurs. You see, according to the Bible, everything was made in 6 days. Now, that means everything, including dinosaurs, which means people and dinosaurs must have lived at the same earth, on the same earth at the same time, at one point in history. Now, by the way, dinosaurs were not all big. In fact, the average size of a dinosaur was probably just a bit bigger than a sheep, because lots and lots of dinosaurs fully grown were only about the size of a chicken. If they'd survived today, we might have KFD as well as KFC. But some were very impressive. So we would be surprised if people and dinosaurs did live on the same earth at the same time, then we would expect lots of stories about a time when they did that. Long-age thinking can't tolerate even the Flintstones, because according to long-age belief, the last dinosaur died 65 million years before the first person appeared on Earth. And so are there stories about a time when people lived with impressive creatures, the larger dinosaurs? There sure are. It's not difficult to see the dragons of legend as very likely to do with the dinosaurs of history, sort of obviously distorted with time and retelling. And it's not just China. There are lots of cultures around the globe with dragon stories, but it's much more impressive when you can actually see carvings and sculptures of dinosaurs from hundreds of years ago. Here's a brass engraving from the tomb of Bishop Bell, who died in the 1400s in Carlisle Cathedral in the UK. That's another part of the same engraving. There it is again. If that's not dinosaurs, what creatures are they trying to depict? But guess what? In the 1400s, there were no dinosaur books. There was no science of fossil reconstruction that could work out what a few bones in rocks looked like. In the jungles of Cambodia, there's a very famous tourist destination called Angkor Wat. These are 900-year-old temple ruins, and in all the carved animals, there's one. I reckon you can yell out for me what sort of dinosaur that is, can't you? Yeah, you don't even... It's not only obvious it's a dinosaur, but even what sort of dinosaur, because we only know of one creature with plates along its back like that, fossil or living. By the way, there's lots of examples like that in this book, Dire Dragons, part of the Untold Secrets of Planet Earth series. But much more important scientifically than that is the discovery in recent years, not just a flash in the pan, but over and over, reported in the serious scientific literature, like Science magazine, for example, of soft tissue in dinosaur fossils. Now, I'm not just talking soft, stretchy ligaments. I'm also talking lots and lots of transparent, branching blood vessels, which still have an ooze inside of them that when you squeeze it out and you put that ooze under the microscope, you can still see the nucleated red blood cell appearances. And I'm also talking about the discovery of lots of identifiable proteins like actin, tubulin, collagen, hemoglobin, osteocalcin, and more recently even DNA. Undoubted dinosaur DNA. Lots of tests they did to try and exclude every other possibility. And these are evolutionists reporting this. By the way, you hear about one little scrap of bone claimed to be a missing link, it's all over the papers. Do you hear about these discoveries in the paper? Not much. You know, one of the evolutionists associated with these discoveries, Dr. Mary Schweitzer from the University of Montana. Thank you. She said, when you think about it, the laws of chemistry and biology and everything else that we know say that it should be gone, it should be degraded completely. Friends, if this was only about objective, dispassionate science and not about ideology and really serious, eternal ideology, don't you think that they would say, well, let's trust the laws of science, that they've done pretty good by us so far, and let's seriously question this belief in millions of years? No. The millions of years are sacrosanct. Now we must try and find a way, and there's different propositions put up as to how these things could have lasted for millions of years when they're really not supposed to, according to standard physics and chemistry. You know, friends, millions of years is essential if you want to do away with God, because if you want people to think that maybe the world made itself and so nobody owns us and nobody made us and nobody's got a right to tell us what to do, then you've got to have millions of years to have it believable, to break it down into small steps and so on. You know, friends, one of the reasons why we get all these materials into people's hands, it's not for commercial reasons. We survive on donations. What happens with magazines and books is a very small fraction of that. And it'd be a lot easier for us to sell one or two books. But we just know it's very important because we have testimonies. Probably not a week goes by where we don't hear of somebody sending us an email that says they became a Christian because some Christian shared this information with them. Rod Walsh, who was here with the ARC van just a few days ago, he said after a meeting in rural Victoria, he said three people came up to me after the message and told me that Creation magazine was responsible for their conversion. We're going to have boards going around shortly to give you a chance to become part of this process of getting information into people's hands who wouldn't normally hear it, which can often change lives. Here's one lady who said, sorry, the font is funny, when your Creation magazine arrives in the mail, my sons-in-law get so excited, I get so thrilled to witness their excitement. The information empowers Christians to share the gospel. A man in 2011 said, I was converted when someone gave me a Creation magazine, so I subscribed for 5 of my relatives. 4 of them have now come to the Lord. As a bonus, even if you extend today, you can take advantage of this. If you already subscribe for a 1-year sub free back issue, for 3 years, you can also walk away with that plus a free DVD. Plus, you can add a digital sub for only $4 per annum, less if it's stretched over 3 years, which means that it can be accessed on up to 5 different devices, smartphones, laptops, that sort of thing, which means your children, your grandchildren can view their own copies. And if you're an existing subscriber and you extend by 3 years, print plus dig, you will add the dig free to all of your existing issues. And we're going to be, the boards are going to look like this, that come around any minute. And after you've ticked the box to choose what you want, you then got to repeat that on the right, because after you've filled in all your details there, you then tear that off and you hang on to that, because when you give it to the guys at the book table, they'll give you your freebies. And while those are going around, I'll talk about the books and the materials. If someone says to me, what one book do I get? I'll generally say, well, consider this pack, because it's discounted to about a one book price. You've got the Creation Answers book, the second most popular creation book in the world. Then you've got Refuting Evolution, which is the most popular creation book in the world. It's written by my colleague in the US, Dr. Jonathan Safaty, who's so painfully smart it hurts. I mean, I've watched him play chess against, well, I've just heard that the world chess champion Magnus Carlsen is a freak even among chess champions, because he can play as many as 10 people at once blindfolded. And they're not blindfolded, he is. Jonathan Safaty plays 12 people at once and beats them all. I'm glad he's on our side. But he's also got the gift of concise communication, so this has become a very powerful evolution demolition weapon. And there's a DVD by me as to why it matters, which is all about the first part of my talk, greatly expanded. Safaty has also written a book, Refuting Compromise, about all of these different theories. It's the most powerful biblical, theological, and scientific defense of straightforward Genesis in existence. But, you know, relevant to tonight is this one, Christianity for Skeptics, because it's the first time that someone has packaged the arguments for creation with the well-tried and honorable other arguments for Christianity, like the historical arguments for the resurrection, comparing Christianity to Islam and Eastern religions, the moral argument for God, the cosmological arguments, and so on. Beautifully presented. So check that one out. If you've got Litleys, even the real Litleys, the Please Nana series, Who is God? What is death? Difficult questions answered from Genesis sensitively at kids' level. But a far better way to get those is through our children's pack, where you can get 5 hardcover books for $8 each. Speaking of hardcover books, here's a adult's geology book masquerading as a kid's book. Seriously, Exploring Geology with Mr. Hibb is a cute grasshopper character, but adults learn a lot about how to view the world of rocks and fossils through a biblical worldview. You know, many young people today, you ask them, how did we get here? They say, because, you know, how did we get here means a lot about what everything's all about, doesn't it? You know what the pastor was saying right at the very beginning of this whole evening? And they say, well, evolution. What's the second most popular belief? Is it that God created? No, it's that aliens created us. And so you've got to sort of get to grips with this issue, alien intrusion, UFOs, and the evolution connection. If you're into things like Big Bangs and stars and that sort of thing, this book, Dismantling the Big Bang, has been co-authored by Dr. John Hartnett, who is actually a research professor of physics here at the University of Adelaide. And he speaks for us and writes for us and so on. And he also wrote Starlight Time and the New Physics, which shows you how it's not difficult at all to explain how light could have gotten to us from the most distant star, millions of light years away, in just a few days. You know, there's DVDs on all sorts of things, you know, the age of the Earth and so on. I won't go through them. You can check the subject out for yourself, but if you want a bargain, Get this Core Issues DVD pack because it's discounted right down. Book I wrote quite recently, One Human Family, The Bible, Science, Race and Culture. Just do yourself a favour, or me a favour, and flick through the table of contents and you'll see it's about an amazing number of things. But the primary theme is what modern science has revealed about our incredible relatedness as humans. You see, according to evolution, we're supposed to have got our differences in different so-called races from tens of thousands of years of separate evolution. According to the Bible, we all go back to Noah, his three sons and their wives, and before that, to one couple, Adam and Eve, about 6,000 years ago. Modern science today has done away with that old evolutionary idea that there's all these differences between different groups that are huge and unbridgeable, and shown that we're all astonishingly closely related. In fact, theories of human evolution have had to be hastily rejigged to cope with this unexpected, in evolutionary thinking, result. And people say, well, how can that be? What about all those different colours and so on? Well, guess what? We're all just different combinations, different amounts of the same stuff. You see, those two girls are actually twins. They have the same father, the same mother. You know, what about the skin colour? You know, if you've got all information to pump out this brown pigment that we all have in our skin called melanin, if you have the information to pump out a lot of it in your skin, people might call you black, but you're actually dark brown. Take a closer look. You know, people actually call me white, and I tell them, hey, my shirt's white, I'm not. Can you see the difference? Because I've actually got, oh, I'm a little bit pinkish, but that's because I don't have enough of this sunscreen melanin to stop the redness of my blood vessels from shining through. The same is true for the colour of your eyes. You have the information for a lot of melanin, you've got brown eyes. For a little bit, you have blue eyes. There's no blue paint in blue eyes. It's just an optical effect from the light scattering from that little bit of melanin. Same stuff. You know, same with the hair. Information for a lot, you have brown or black hair. For a little bit, you have blonde hair. Am I saying that blue-eyed blondes have less information? No, I'm not. But no, I'm not. But what I am saying is that you can deduce that Adam and Eve could not have been, as they're often drawn, blue-eyed, blonde-haired, pale-skinned and so on, because they wouldn't have had the information to give rise to all the people groups. You see, two brown-eyed parents like these with the right mix of genes can have both blue-eyed and brown-eyed offspring, but two blue-eyed parents generally can't have any brown-eyed offspring. They don't have the information and so on. So Adam and Eve would have been middle brown and everything, brown hair, brown eyes, brown skin, like most of the world's population. Surprise, surprise. So many ways in which modern science is actually catching up with the Bible. So I'll leave you with the thought of creation.